Thank you. Or you should ask question and then we will answer. Okay, both ways.
Okay sir.
Thank you. Study ठीक चल रहा है? पढ़ाई ठीक हो रहा है?
हाँ सर, हाँ सर.
अच्छा अब तो 3 मई तक हो गया है ना कर्फ्यू, तो एग्जाम थोड़ा लेट हो जाएगा आपका, ठीक है
सर? सर
थ्योरी भी और फिर प्रैक्टिकल भी, तो बताएंगे
सर, आपको ओके सर.
जो आएगा वहाँ से एग्जाम सेक्शन से
जी सर.
तो लेकिन सबको यही रहना है, कहीं जाना तो है, ठीक है
जी सर.
ठीक है, सीमेंट में ना हम लोग बैठते हैं, तो सीमेंट में आ जाया करिए करीब लंच के बाद, तो वहाँ डिस्कस कर लिया करेंगे टॉपिक. मैनेजमेंट ऑफ अर्ली ब्रेस्ट कैंसर. सो बट बिफोर वी स्टार्ट दिस सेशन, दिस टॉपिक ऑन अर्ली ब्रेस्ट कैंसर, लेट अस अप्रिशिएट what do we mean by early breast cancer, what do we mean by late breast cancer or advanced breast cancer, and what do we mean by metastatic breast cancer, right? So we can classify breast cancer at presentation. A lady may have very small tumor, which we can call early breast cancer, which is defined as T1, T2 lesions, usually N0, but some people will also include N1 disease. But I feel that once you have axillary node metastasis, it has spread. You know, it has spread from the primary site, from the mammary gland, to the regional lymph node. So prognosis, treatment, everything changes dramatically. And therefore, although classically we have been including T1, T2, N0 and N1 as early breast cancer, but real early is just T1, N0. That is real early, less than 2 centimeter and no axillary nodes. That is really early, and we can offer 90 to 95% cure rate, 10-year survival, recurrence-free survival in this group. So that is real early, just T1 and N0. So the classically in the exam, you should say T1, T2, N0 and N1 will be called early breast cancer. When patient comes first to the clinic, you don't know whether the advanced stage on the pectoral region, that is, it is T3 or T4, has metastasized or not. So on the first visit, you can only use the term advanced breast cancer. Okay, you do not as yet know whether it is locally advanced or has gone to elsewhere in the body, that is hematogenous spread mostly into lungs, liver, brain and bones. LLBB, you know the law degree LLB, everybody knows in law degree is called LLB, so you can remember LLBB, lungs, liver, brain and bone. These are 4 common sites where breast cancer spreads through the blood bone metastasis. So on the first visit, when lady comes and she does not have a PET CT scan or contrast CT scan, bone scan report with her, you do not know whether it is only locally advanced in the breast area or it has also gone elsewhere in the body. So we can just use the word advanced breast cancer. Then you arrange metastatic workup, and based on that, then you say, okay, there is no metastasis elsewhere. It is T3 and T4 tumor or N2 in the axilla, matted lymph nodes matted to either each other or matted to surrounding structures in the armpit, namely the axillary vessels, brachial plexus, chest wall, pectoral muscles, rib cage. So that is N2 disease, or you have supraclavicular node, that is also N3 disease. So on first visit, you can only use the word advanced breast cancer, ABC. Then you arrange metastatic workup negative for metastasis elsewhere in the body. So you say locally advanced breast cancer, LABC. Okay. So immediately on clinical assessment, you can never use the word LABC, locally advanced. You have to do metastatic workup in the form of contrast CT scan of the chest, abdomen, pelvis with isotope bone scan. If facilities exist, you can do fluorinated 18 FDG PET which will assess the entire body for any metastasis. Okay, if metastasis are negative, then you use the word locally advanced breast cancer for. So locally advanced breast cancer is what? T3, T4, N2 or N3 with no metastasis revealed on metastatic workup. If there are metastasis, then we say metastatic breast cancer, MBC. Okay, and we'll have that metastatic workup discussion later on, maybe on a separate day. But just remember quick formula for the exam. M for M, metastasis, medical oncology, medical treatment, right? No role of surgery or very limited role of surgery for palliative, etc. So with that introduction, let us take the topic of staging. So staging, why do we stage the patients? We have to stage in using clinical parameters, that is size of the lump measured by vernier caliper, its involvement of the overlying skin or underlying chest wall, and then a pathological staging in the form of biopsy of the primary tumor, biopsy of the regional lymph nodes, and if there are metastatic foci, even biopsy of those metastatic deposits are currently recommended. Now, aim of the staging is assess the treatment planning, decide the treatment planning. Patient's relatives or patient themselves want to know how long will they live, whether they will have cure of their disease, or will they have only palliation of their disease or prolongation of life for a few months. So they want to prognostication. And third reason is we want to study the disease, its natural history of different types of presentation, and therefore, we want to stage the disease. And then, of course, when we conduct studies, when we conduct research, and one physician in, say, one country wants to communicate in the form of research publication or conference and meetings, there we want to communicate among the physicians. And if we use the same language, then it is so much easier. So I say T1, and a surgeon in America also uses T1, means less than 2 centimeter tumor, and in Bangladesh also less than 2 centimeter tumor. So everybody speaks the same language. Nobody speaks Greek or somebody speaking Latin. Okay, same language. So therefore, you need same staging language, that is TNM. Okay, so the TNM is an acronym for tumor node and metastasis staging. It was started by a gentleman called Pierre Dunoy in the late 40s, 1947-48 in Paris. And he initially recommended only the clinical or anatomical staging, tumor node metastasis. Till recently, we were using only this anatomical staging in the 7th edition. Currently, we are using 8th edition, and we'll just go on to what has changed in the 8th edition. So this is the staging. If we are not able to assess for some reason, primary tumor has been removed by lumpectomy by somebody else, and you don't know its results, histology results, so you just say TX. Okay. If there is no evidence of primary tumor, then say T0. T1S is in situ. IS is the suffix for in situ tumor. IS. So you can say TIS, DCIS, or TLCIS, ductal carcinoma in situ, lobular carcinoma in situ. Now, if somebody is listening, then they should answer what is the LCIS changed in the current edition. Can somebody tell me?
Sir, it's no more carcinoma in situ. Yeah.
Very
no more
considered. It's not a cancer anymore. It is.
Yeah.
It's a predisposing factor. Yeah. It's a precursor. It's a high risk lesion. So women who have LCIS, they have 10 times risk of developing breast cancer in the future. Where? In the same breast or in the opposite breast?
Sir, in both, it can be in both the breasts.
Both, same or opposite. Okay, same or opposite. We have seen some ladies, you know, they had presentation in one breast. 8 years later, she came with cancer in the opposite. So LCIS, lobular lesions have a high incidence of bilaterality. And can somebody tell the rule of 10 for lobular lesion? Last time we discussed.
Sir, 10% common, 10% bilateral.
Right. 10% of all cancers are lobular in nature. 90% ductal, 10% lobular. 10% bilateral, 10% multicentric. Okay. 10% incidence, all cancers, 10% bilateral, 10% multicentric. That's why we have to do one test. What is that? MRI of the breast.
MRI.
If there is lobular lesion, you must do MRI. Why? To pick up small multicentric lesions in the same breast as well as in the opposite breast because of this rule of 10. Okay? Okay. So, but current edition of the 8th edition of TNM does not include LCIS as a cancer. Right? Achha, then Paget's disease. Paget's disease is still a type of in situ lesion. It's a special type of in situ lesion which is present only in the nipple. It presents as an erosion of the nipple, right? Erosion of the nipple. But it's a special, peculiar type of in situ cancer presenting on the tip of the nipple. And there are two theories about Paget's disease, whether it is arising from the ducts and then ductal cancer progresses, comes to the surface, presents on the surface as nipple erosion, or it is arising primarily from the epidermis over the nipple. Okay. So, dermatotrophic theory of Paget's disease, it's a primary tumor arising from the nipple. Because you have some unique Paget cells on histology, remember in pathology classes, they taught you special presence of Paget cell, which is large eosinophilic cytoplasm, a large cell, which is not seen in any other type of breast cancer, ductal or lobular. So there's a unique Paget cell present only in Paget's disease. So some people believe that it is not a ductal carcinoma progressing to nipple. Okay, so it's unique type. So that's about its theory. So Paget's disease is a type of in situ cancer, and you have to write TIS within bracket Paget's. And what do you do to confirm Paget's disease? As soon as a lady in cancer age group, say 30 plus age group, comes to you and she has erosion of the nipple, you must take wedge biopsy from the nipple. Wedge biopsy, take her to the minor operation theater with an 11 number plate, take a wedge, about 3-4 millimeter diameter wedge, like a cone, you know, take a wedge from the nipple, eroded part of the nipple, and that will confirm the presence of Paget's disease. T1 tumor, less than 2 centimeter. If you have 2.000000, you will call it T1 or T2?
T2.
The examiners often ask in the exam. No. It is 2.00000. It is T1. See here. Can you read here? Third line. Less than sign or equal to. So up to 2 centimeter or 20 millimeter in the maximum dimension. It's T1. And then they have further classified into three categories based on their prognosis. If it is less than 5 millimeter, it is called T1A. Why this classification? Because many people believe, oncologists believe, that if it is less than 5 millimeter, you don't need to offer her chemotherapy. Okay? Less than 5 millimeter, no need of chemotherapy. Just surgery and radiotherapy. T1B, 5 to 10 millimeter. And T1C, more than 10, that is less than 20, 10 to 20. So ABC classification based on their outcome and treatment planning. T2 greater than, so 2.0001 will be called T2. Okay, but it should be less than 5. So 5.1 will become 5.1?
T3.
Thank you. So you are listening. Right. So T3 and T4 have been classically called advanced breast carcinoma. Right? It can be locally advanced LABC or metastatic. We don't know. unless you have done metastatic breast cancer. So, but T3, T4, advanced breast carcinoma, T1, T2, early breast. TY, actually you should say T1S, TIS, T1 and T2. All three are early breast cancer, right? Okay. Now, students often get confused which is T4A and which is T4B. So, I use an expression in Hindi, A se andar, B se bahar. Do you understand? Andar means inside. In Hindi, andar means inside. So, if tumor, tumor in the breast can go to its neighbors, and neighbor of the breast are what? Chest wall inside, pectoral muscle, then or serratus muscle in lower, and then intercostal muscles, periosteum of the rib, or costal cartilage, then the rib itself, or in the exact midline, you will have a sternum also, body of the sternum, right? So these are the posterior neighbors. Anterior neighbor of the breast is skin, dermis, and nipple areola. Okay, so it is a general formula for all TNMs. T1, T2, T3 are based on the size. So in say oral cavity, again T1 is up to 2 cm. Okay, thyroid also T1 2 cm. Most organs, you know, T1 is up to 2 cm. T2
4 cm.
2 to 4 in oral cancer. Head and neck cancer 2 to 4, in breast up to 2 to 5 centimeter, right? So, T3 also more than 5 or more than 4 in oral. So, T1, T2, T3 are based on the size of the primary lesion, okay? T4 means tumor has gone to the neighbor's house. So, just think of the neighbor. You say in the tongue cancer, what is the neighbor? Floor of the mouth or mandible. In thyroid, neighbor of the thyroid is larynx above and below. Okay, and then further to pharynx and other organs. So T4 means tumor has gone to the neighbor's house. Okay, so think of the neighbors of the breast, skin entrant, skin nipple areola, and on the back, chest wall. So just remember this T4A when it has gone to chest wall, and B when it has gone to the skin. And don't get confused, which is A, which is B. A se andar, B se bahar. Will you remember that? A for inside, andar means inside, and B is it's coming out. Okay. And C is when you add A and B. So A plus B is equal to C. Usual equation in algebra. We remember that. If A plus B is equal to C. And D is a special category. D is a special category where tumor is of inflammatory breast carcinoma. Last session, we classified inflammatory carcinoma as that aggressive type of carcinoma where redness and edema more than how much? One third of the surface area of the breast. Usually with short history, less than 6 months. Rapidly progressing cancer, neoplasm, redness and edema, more than one third of the surface area of the breast, with a shorter history, less than 6 months. Okay, that is called T4D. Why it is put as a separate entity? Because it has a very aggressive, in fact, among all the types of breast cancer, it is the most aggressive form of breast cancer. And in spite of a mastectomy, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and all other targeted therapies, most patients are dead with it. I have yet to remember a patient who has survived for more than 2 years in our group, in our cohort, who had inflammatory carcinoma, very aggressive. Now we come to end staging. If you cannot assess it clearly, somebody has already done a biopsy or dissection, so you just put NX. N0 is a no regional node metastasis. N1, this will be, initially it was only on the clinical palpation, but now when we say N0, it is clinical plus sonographic, because current generation breast surgeon has to sit in his clinic with an ultrasound machine. He or she has to learn the art and science of using sonography. Okay, sonography of the breast, maxilla, fingers. So N0 means no regional lymph nodes palpable to her fingers, examiner's fingers, and no suspicious nodes seen on ultrasound. Okay, that is N0. N1 is metastasis, but still node is mobile. It's still in the same breast. Initially, number of nodes were not counted. Whether I'm palpating one node or 10 nodes, I would still call it N1. And that's a lacuna, you know, that's a deficiency of this clinical classification. Because, I mean, common sense dictates that as the number of nodal metastases increases, probably disease is progressing and becoming more and more advanced. But initially, numbers were not counted, okay? And when we said N1, we meant those nodes which are palpable to your fingers or easily readily seen on the sonography. And if you take the anatomical levels, level 1, you know, lateral to pectoralis minor, level 2, axillary lymph nodes, which are lying behind the pectoralis minor, okay? Level 3, which are superomedial to pectoralis minor, also called level 3 nodes. What's the other name for level 3 nodes? Apical nodes. Apical. No. Supraclavicular is different. Apical nodes. Supraclavicular is N3, right? Supraclavicular is not included as part of the breast nodes. No, it's not axillary node. It is above the clavicle, as the name indicates. Right? So, apical nodes. Apical nodes are also called level 3 nodes. Okay? And then N2 has further been divided. Whether N2A, ipsilateral level 1, fixed to one another, that is matted nodes, or to other structures, and to be metastasis only in clinically detected ipsilateral internal memory. Now, this is, I think, very confusing for students. Students think that they will be able to palpate the internal memory nodes, but that is not true. Internal memory nodes are hidden behind the intercostal space, behind the costal cartilages, along the internal mammary vessels at the parasternal edge. So how can you feel them? They used to be palpable in 50 years ago when our teachers were studying breast cancer. In those days, patients came really very late, and then some patients did come with palpable internal mammary nodes. So you can imagine with knowledge of anatomy that nodes of the internal mammary chain will become palpable when they emerge through the intercostal space. Then only they will be palpable to your fingers, right? Sometimes in the follow-up clinic, patients who were operated for advanced cancer years ago, ladies come with a swelling, a bulge in the parasternal edge, and then you should suspect internal mammary node metastasis or recurrence. It's a type of local regional recurrence. One day maybe we'll talk about various types of recurrences and how to manage them. So it is a local regional recurrence, internal memory chain metastasis, and you must arrange a contrast CT scan of the chest. Contrast CT scan of the chest, and if you have an expert radiologist who can take biopsy for you, you must always get the biopsy from that suspicious internal memory node. So, but clinically, it is very difficult to palpate these. Okay. N3A, B, and C. This is infraclavicular. Infraclavicular, we yesterday discussed in the last session. Nodes located in the which triangle? Can somebody recall?
Deltopectoral triangle.
Ah, very good memory. Really, I'm really grateful to you. Thank you. Thank you. Deltopectoral triangle, right? So, by the way, did all of you get a copy of the video on clinical examination or not?
No,
if not, then Dr. Rijuta can share it.
The copy is given to people who are in WhatsApp group.
Thank you. So, there is a diagram, you know, of a lady where we have drawn infraclavicular node in the deltopectoral triangle between deltoid Hallucis major and clavicle. Inferior border of the clavicle. Inferior border. Right. And then this statement, the ipsilateral internal memory with axillary, this is based on the CT scan. Right. Hardly ever you will get this palpable node. So this is a CT point. Right. And N3C, supraclavicular nodes, along with that. So that's an advanced stage. M is what? When you do not have any clinical or radiological or biochemical or even biochemical. If alkaline phosphatase is raised, which arouses the suspicion of what? If alkaline phosphatase is markedly elevated,
bone metastasis.
What about liver metastasis? Can there be liver metastasis? Alkaline phosphatase is also elevated in liver disease, isn't it?
But only in obstructive liver disease.
So there are different isomers. See, in the exam you should say there are different isomers of alkaline phosphatase. One is bone related isomer, which will be so special laboratories will estimate special isomers from bone and from liver. Okay, but in both diseases you will have raised alkaline phosphatase. Okay, and or when you suspect metastasis based on clinical history and examination, lady is 55 and she never had any arthritis or osteoarthrosis, and for last 3 months she is complaining of lower backache or pain in the hip region, or in fact she had fallen in the bathroom, she had slipped in the bathroom and fractured her neck femur. Okay, postmenopausal lady, very common scenario. And so she has pathological fracture of the bone. Even. So you should suspect bony metastasis. Okay, even if tumor is small. So M1 will be when we have clinical or radiological feature, all these days, even biochemical features. So, and now they say that we must confirm the presence by histology. Appropriate histology, biopsy of the mediastinal lymph nodes or lung biopsy, or if we have pleural effusion, you can collect the pleural fluid and put some heparin as and send it for cytology. So who will tell why should we add heparin in that cytology fluid for pleural aspirate or ascitic fluid?
It coagulates.
So usually we collect 200 ml as much as possible. What about 200 ml of pleural fluid or ascitic fluid with about, I think, 1 ml of heparin or 1,000 units. Some very small amount of heparin. The idea is to prevent fibrinogen getting converted to fibrin, which will entrap all the cancer cells if they are floating. Okay. So, you add heparin to prevent the fibrinogen getting, because this is exudative fluid mostly, isn't it? The cancer metastatic fluid, the fluid in the pleural cavity or in the ascitic, malignant ascites, it's mostly exudative type because of it is pouring out of the lymphatic blockade, right? So it contains proteins more than 3 g/cm, that is exudate. So this large amount of protein will cause coagulation and the fibrinogen will form fibrin and fibrin will entrap all the cells. So you don't want that. You want to centrifuge this fluid and get the sediment of cells and then make a smear and slide and see the cancer cells. Okay. So that's why you add heparin. So this is about M0 and M1. Now, what were the limitations of this classical TNM? It was only treatment planning was changed when we introduced a TNM classification. Before that, everybody was just doing mastectomy. Before 70s, everybody was doing Halstead radical mastectomy. And then later on, people changed to modified radical mastectomy after Sir David Beatty in England and Maiden, M-A-D-E-N, Maiden in America. Almost the same time, they demonstrated that if patient does not have involvement of pectoralis major, we can preserve pectoralis major and remove only pectoralis minor. And this was the modification of the radical mastectomy, hence it was called modified radical mastectomy, modified MRM. So MRM in the English speaking or British influenced part of the world is called Beatty mastectomy after Sir David Beatty in 1948, first described it in British Journal of Cancer, 1948, volume 2, page 7. You can note the reference. You can download it free. It's a classical paper. You should read it. Sir David Beatty, the prognosis of cancer of the breast in relation to type of the operation performed, British Journal of Cancer, 1948, volume 2, page 7. Classical paper, you must read it. Beatty, Sir David Beatty. Okay. And in America, same operation is called Maiden, M-A-D-E-N, Maiden's mastectomy.
It's 1830.
Now, why do we have to classify according to E&M? Because we need to decide when to perform BCS, that is breast conservation surgery, and when to perform mastectomy. So planning for breast cancer conservation surgery is based on the tumor size, the breast size. Usual rule is less than 4 cm tumor with appropriate size of the breast, you can offer breast conservation. If tumor is more than 4 cm or breast is really small, even if 3 cm tumor, we can offer. And lady still wants breast conservation, what will you do? It's 3.5 cm tumor, but the breast is very small. And she said, no, doctor, don't remove my whole breast. Try to preserve my breast. What will you do? Neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
Or we can do oncoplasties.
Okay. Oh, well, oncoplasty is still, you will remove more tumor, 3.5, if you take 1 cm margin all around, 3.5 plus 2, one on this side, one on this side, so it will be at least 5.5, which is quite a bit of stuff, tissue. So we can offer neoadjuvant chemotherapy to downsize, don't say downstage, say downsize the tumor, right? Stage is like, when people in India are born, they are often taken to priest who will make Janampatri. Do you know Janampatri? Janampatri, they make Janampatri. They decide which kundali, they make your kundali. So, stage is like Janampatri or Janam kundali. You are born with it and you can't change it. So, if patient was T4B N1 M1, for her life, on her file, we will keep recording that as she is Mrs. Agrawal, Mrs. Gupta, is T4B N1 M0. Okay. That stage never changes. What changes is the size. So in the exam, you should say that I will arrange neoadjuvant chemotherapy or neoadjuvant hormone therapy with the objective of downsizing the tumor, not downstaging, downsizing. Okay. Downsizing. So, we consider tumor to breast ratio, location of the tumor, position and all, right? We'll discuss the principles of BCS in a moment, okay? So this is, so other things, well, not taken into account in the classical TNM, right? Where is the tumor? That is not, recorded in TNM. Wherever it is retroarular or it is single or multifocal, it was also not recorded in the classical TNM, multifocal or multicentricity. These are two terms. Can somebody define what is multifocal?
Multifocal is any tumor which is less, two tumors, the distance between them is less than 4 cm. Whereas in a multicentric, there are 4 tumors and the distance between the tumors is more than 5 cm. 4 cm.
Why this? What is this magic figure? Did Jesus Christ or Allah give you a dream that you should have this 4 cm margin? How did you get this magic figure, 4 cm? Did you read Bible or Quran Sharif or Bhagavad Gita? Did you read it? See, it is assumed that breast cancer arises from the epithelium of the ductal cells. 90% are ductal in origin, 10% nobular. Mostly they are ductal in origin, okay? So if the tumor arises from one ductolobular system, and then it spreads within the lumen of the ducts, it's called cancerization of the ducts. Cancerization of the duct. Like a creeping reptile, it creeps within the lumen. Just as you have read in colon cancer, there is transluminal spread. From transverse colon, it can go to this, you know, sigmoid colon and rectum. So, seedling of the cells. So, within the lumen of the duct, cancer also can grow. Either creeping like a reptile or emboli. You know, gets fed off from A and then goes to B. So, intraluminal spread. Intraluminal spread, it's called cancerization of the duct. Similarly, there can be cancerization of the lobules. So, if it has spread from one part and gone to the neighboring part, is still part of that mother tumor, one tumor cells. And its behavior, its receptor status, and treatment will also be similar, right? Whereas, and you can still do lumpectomy. You can still do breast conservation. So that is the rationale of taking this figure, magic figure of 4 centimeters. We assume that these two tumor foci located within 4 centimeter distance are part of the same cell, and from one to other point A to point B, they have gone by way of cancerization of the ducts. Okay. If they are wide apart, say one tumor is in upper outer quadrant 12 o'clock, other is at 6 o'clock. So it's reasonable to assume that they have arisen, they have developed from two different ductolobular system. Okay. If you recall that Andy movie, did everybody get Andy movie? A-N-D-I?
Yes, sir. It is sent. Yeah.
Okay. So, you can see that there are 7 to 8 lobes, and each lobe has lobules, and then lobules have acini, right? So, if they have arisen, they are arising from two different ductolobular system, especially they are very wide apart, then their two lumps cannot be encompassed, cannot be removed by a lumpectomy. You have to perform full mastectomy. So that is multicentric. So multicentric, more than two foci, two or more located in two different quadrants or in two diagonally opposite parts of the breast, usually arising. Achha, this is about 4 centimeters is still, you know, is a arbitrary figure. Now, can you, with the knowledge of genetics, can you do some precise test which will say it is multifocal or multicentric? Can somebody answer this?
We can do a genomic signature of each of the tumors, and if they're exactly same, then they must be multifocal. If they're different, they could be multicentric.
Right. Just as two human beings have some difference in their genomes. So, no two human beings, even isogenic twins, may have some differences in their genomic signature. If you do the whole genome sequencing, similarly, two tumors arising from two different stem cells. It is believed that cancer arises from the stem cells. So, tumors of the two stem cells will have different genomic signatures. So, you can do genomic signature. That will prove for sure whether it is multicentric or not. Initially, in situ was not classified based on size. So these are the lacunae of the conventional DNM. Okay. So I'll give you a copy of this. You can make notes. Distance. But when we are evaluating a patient in the preoperative workup, preoperative planning, and before giving options to the lady in multidisciplinary team, you must assess these, ascertain these. Size of the tumor, tumor to breast ratio, distance of the skin and nipple areola, and distance from the pectoral muscle. Because if it is sitting, abutting on the pectoral muscle, you may have to remove a sliver of a layer of pectoral muscle to get negative margin. Right. And then whether, if it is in situ tumor, whether we should do nodal assessment or not is a question. And we can have a separate session for in situ neoplasms. Okay. Because their principles of management are different. So we'll do one session. Dr. Yutha, please note, we'll have on in situ lesions. Okay. In situ lobular and situ ductal, both. So this, all this was not included in conventional CNM. Now, you say that 2.1 and up to 5 is T2. Yes?
Yes.
But at tumor 2.1 will behave very differently than tumor which is 4.9 or 5. You know that it's double the size. It has traveled in the natural history of the breast tumor. You know, have you read something about doubling time, tumor doubling time?
Yes, sir.
And cell cycle time, you know. So, it is assumed that when tumor has reached clinical size of 1 centimeter, it has a cell population is about 10 to power 7 cells, and it has been in the body for about 5 to 7 years. Right? So, 1 centimeter. 1 millimeter is about 10 to power 5 cells, 1 million cells. 1 millimeter. So, the cell population is doubled in 5 centimeter versus 2 centimeter, and yet we will lump them in one basket. So it is like putting very large apples and tiny, or you know, apples in the same basket. So 2 and 5 will not behave similarly, and yet so far we have been putting them in the same basket, that is T2. So that is a lacuna of the conventional TNM. Okay. So these are some of the pathological markers were not included. Now we know that prognosis of the cancer of the breast, invasive cancer of the breast, varies in direct proportion to the number of pathological lymph nodes involved in the excision. Now there is a lot of data to show that. And more than 10 nodes involvement in the axilla in invasive cancer is considered heavy nodal burden and aggressive disease. So this was not counted in the traditional DNM. And now came a molecular classification, which is based on the origin of cells, whether it's from luminal A cell, which is rich in estrogen receptor, often rich in progesterone receptor, negative for expression of HER2-neu. What is full form HER2-neu?
Human epidermal receptor.
Human epidermal receptor type 2. There are four types of human epidermal receptors.
Yes,
type 1, 2, 3, and 4. EGF. The general name is EGF, epidermal growth factor. You know EGF? So epidermal growth factor receptor type 1, 2, 2, 3, and 4. So type 2 is called HER2. And there are four types. And mitosis of these luminal A type of tumor is very low. So Ki-67 is a marker of mitosis, mitotic activity of the cancer. So they count the number of cells in mitotic phase and classify as low Ki-67 index and high. What is low and high? Can somebody tell? The cutoff varies in different studies.
Yes.
Please give some guidelines. Some.
According to, I mean, there's no standard criteria, but still for convenience or to be on the same, convention wise, 11, less than 11%, I mean, 10% or less is
Less than 10 is considered low, right? So low mitotic index. So the luminal A, luminal B, ER positive, PGR may be present or low, again, HER negative, but they have high mitosis. So the difference between A and B, receptor-wise, they are similar, but mitosis is more in luminal B. Okay, mitosis is more in luminal B. Luminal B, there is one type where HER expression, receptor can express. So it is called luminal B HER2 positive and luminal B HER2 negative. Okay, and again, it can be high or low or any on Ki-67. But usually higher than luminal A. Okay, more aggressive disease. So if you want to decide whether to give chemotherapy or not, tumor is say 2 centimeter and luminal A type node negative, then you may say, okay, luminal A, it is very good prognosis, low mitotic index, and we may avoid chemotherapy. Okay, if it is T1 N0 tumor and luminal A. If it is type B, high mitotic index, you might as well give chemotherapy even if it is node negative and small tumor. So this is how it is helpful in deciding the adjuvant therapy and deciding the prognosis. HER2 receptor overexpressed, other receptors being absent, estrogen, progesterone, and this is called HER rich. And the fourth type, or fifth type rather, basal-like, arising from the basal cells. If you recall that ANDI film, we had shown the structure of a lobule, base inner luminal cells or A cells, outside basal cells or B cells. So it's arising from those basal cells, and therefore basal cells do not have milk production, so they lack estrogen and progesterone receptors, and they all lack all three receptors. So it is called triple negative, all three receptors negative, also called triple negative, basal like. Okay. Now this classification can be done anywhere in any country where you have facility, immunohistochemistry facility for doing ER, PR, HER and Ki-67. But ideally, do you know, in the exam, if somebody asks, how do we classify the tumors on molecular basis? You should say that we use what? No. This is a surrogate.
Immunohistochemistry is a surrogate.
Actually, it is a genomic study again. It's called PAM50. Gene signature. PAM50. PAM50 genomic signature is the genomic testing for these marks. Original paper, if you read molecular classification, original paper was published based on PAM50 genomic classification. And since that genomic classification is not available in most countries, it is very expensive. So pathologists came out with this surrogate, and usually it works well. Usually it works well, but not in all the time. So basal like, all three negative, triple negative, and ABN, HER rich. Okay, in the original AJCC up to 7, we had not included the receptor status, grading, and oncotype DX, and response to treatment. So in the 8th edition, so in the exam, they may ask, what is new in 8th edition? Dr. Chintamani often asks this, you know, in the scope or the exam. So you should remember when he is the examiner. It's anatomical plus biomarker plus response to therapy. If you have offered neoadjuvant chemotherapy or neoadjuvant hormone therapy, then response to therapy is also taken into consideration when making the classification, AJCC 8th edition TNM classification, response to therapy. And you put the prefix Y, T1, T2. Hormone receptor is logical grading. If you have oncotype DX, it's a 21 gene signature to decide whether patient has low recurrence score or high recurrence score, or now they have an intermediate recurrence score. Three classification based on 21 gene signature. They assess 21 genes responsible for invasion, for mitosis, and for angiogenesis. Angiogenesis, invasion, and right. So that's a 21 gene signature. What is the other gene signature available for this?
Mama print,
which is a 70 gene signature developed in the
Amsterdam.
Amsterdam study. But that is more expensive. That is 70 genes. It's more precise because you are studying 70 genes, 7070. But Oncotype DX is more widely available, and they are now randomized trial based on Oncotype DX, 21 genes. All this is included in AJCC 8th edition. So it is more precise. It's anatomical plus biomarkers. These biomarkers, ER, PRH, TRH, HI, KI, and response to any therapy, neoadjuvant therapy. Okay. And then based on that, in the 8th edition, they have published all these long pink tables. I deliberately not increase their size because I don't want you to read them. T1, T2, N0 and all that, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want you to read them. But they are published in 8th edition. It is freely available in the web. You know, just type AJC 8th edition and you get a free download PDF file. So in the exam, somebody may ask, should I remember all this stage grouping? No, you will faint, you know, if you try to remember all this. So don't remember this because it is not used in diagnostic workup. It's not used in therapy planning. It's only used in writing the reports or doing some research. I want to do a randomized trial of some patient by some therapy and somebody else in America or Holland or Hong Kong also wants to do it. So mostly for research purpose, we use this classification. But day-to-day clinical management, we do not use this, right? And it is available on this website. So this is about initial staging. So it's clinical plus imaging plus biomarker, okay? Screen sharing is stopped. Now we go to our next presentation, which is is a PowerPoint. Can you see
yes,
this?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'll make full screen. I'll leave this data for a later lecture on screening. Okay. I'll just leave all this. Yes. So we were talking about multicentric and multifocal, right? So if this is these bluish black are the major milk ducts. Major milk ducts. They're 15 to 20 deep to the nipple. 15 to 20. Okay. But milk comes only from 7. The other 7 are blind. Okay. If you count these ducts, you take a cross section here, just deep to the nipple, you will get 15 ducts. But if you go deeper, you will find that only 7 are connected to these milk duct system and other 7 are blind ducts. Anyway, so these are called major milk ducts, major mammary ducts. And then you have smaller and smaller secondary and tertiary ducts until they become very tiny and small. And in the final ductule is called terminal duct
lobular unit.
Terminal ductal lobular unit or TDLU. TDLU. Okay. Most cancers arise from TDLU. Now imagine. So there is a.
Sir, can we recap how many acini, how many lobules are there once?
Okay, you tell me. 7 to 8 lobes in each breast. Each lobe has about 30 to 40 lobe. Right? Lobe. Each lobe has 30 to 40 lobules. Mm-hmm. And each lobule has 10 to 100 SNI. So this, the mammary gland is called racemose gland, and racemose is the word from botany, which means bunch of grapes, racemose, R-A-C-E-M-O-S-E. Mammary gland is, even pancreas is described as racemose, isn't it? Pancreas, parotid, I think most, you know, some mandibular gland, salivary gland, most of them are this like this, right? Okay. So racemose means like a bunch of grape. So this one grape is one acinus or milk secreting unit. One acinus, right? Hmm. Acinus is one grape. And then you have terminal ductule and then bigger and bigger ducts till you get this major milk duct. So imagine cancer is arising from this lobule. Okay. This travels through this terminal ductule and goes to next duct. So it is arising from here. It's arising. Can you see this cursor?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So suppose it is arising from here. Okay. So it travels along the duct like a reptile, creeps into the lumen, and then goes to this area and grows there. So you have one cancer here and one cancer there. They are located within same ductal lobular system, right? And because it has arisen from one cell, stem cell, you will have same genomic signature. And usually, they will be located within the same region, less than 4 centimeters apart. So this is the term multifocal. Multifocal. Okay. One primary focus, and then it's offspring. Just as in the rainy season, you know, you see a lot of mushrooms, you know, other plants coming up on the garden, you know. You can see those and then small branches come off, you know. So from the, you put grass and or money plant, and then small branches come from the side. So all this is example of multifocal. Multifocal. Okay, multicentric is one cell.
Here, can we install paneer there?
No problem. You can hear the sound?
Yes. Click on no.
No problem. Hello.
Can you mute everybody who is not presenting? Can you mute?
Join on a request, schedule on a
call. Let me do it.
Cherry.
Others, please mute.
Should I continue or not?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So, if one tumor arises from this lobule, and other tumor arises from this lobule, they are wide apart. They are arising from different ductolobular systems. So, you cannot remove both together without removing the entire ductolobular system. That means without doing a mastectomy. Okay. So that's the rationale of doing mastectomy for multicentric tumor. So one tumor arising from here, one tumor arising from here. So they are wide apart and they are arising from different ductolobular systems, different lobes. That's why we have to do full mastectomy. So multicentric tumor, full mastectomy. And because they are arising from two different stem cells, their genomic signature will also be different. So multicentric, mastectomy, different cells, different ductolobular system. Multifocal, same ductal segment, same lobes, and we can do a larger lumpectomy and get the tumor-free margin. Okay, so that's the concept between multifocal and multicentric. Multifocal, multicentric. All right? So, and this is the TDLU concept, you know. You saw that. Terminal ductule and then the lobule together called terminal ductal lobular unit. Most cancers arise from here. Now it is believed that normal ducts and the lobules have one layer of cell, one layer luminal, one basal. All right. If the cells undergo hyperplasia, they become more than two layers. It's called hyperplasia. So what's the definition of hyperplasia? More than two layers of cells. All right. Hello.
Yes, sir. Please.
More than two layers of cells is called hyperplasia. Okay. Two layers of cells in the ducts will be called ductal hyperplasia. Two layers of cells in the lobule will be called lobular hyperplasia. But still, there is no abnormality. The cells are looking normal. Then something happens and their change, you know, their appearance and then function changes. They become atypical, abnormal looking cells, dysplastic cells. And then they use the term atypical ductal hyperplasia. Okay, atypical ductal hyperplasia. If this ADH is present only into two ducts, okay, or if the entire lesion measures 2 millimeter. So rule of two, just remember rule of two. What is rule of two? More than two layer of cells, hyperplasia. Then up to two ducts, ADH. More than two ducts, ductal carcinoma in situ. Up to 2 millimeter, ADH. More than two millimeter in size, ductal carcinoma in situ. So rule of two, okay? More than two layers of cells, looking abnormal, confined to two ducts, atypical ductal hyperplasia. More than two ducts,
BCIS.
Size on histology 2 millimeter or less, ADH. More than 2 millimeter, carcinoma in situ. So it is rule of two. Just remember rule of two. Okay. It's so important to get a very thorough examination of this area by an experienced pathologist. Otherwise, ADH will be misclassified as DCIS and unnecessary treatment will be given, unnecessary radiotherapy. ADH is a benign lesion. It's a high-risk lesion. You just need a removal of the ADH. Margin negativity need not be there because it's not a cancer. It's a precursor of cancer. ADH has a relative risk of cancer formation about 4 to 5. So a lady with ADH and lady without ADH. Lady with ADH has a 4 times greater risk of developing cancer than somebody without ADH. 4 times. It's a high-risk lesion. High-risk lesion. Okay? And after lumpectomy, after removal of the ADH lesion, lump or lesion, you should put them on, you should discuss, you know, you should discuss the various options. One is tamoxifen, 20 milligram daily.
It's 19 hours.
Tamoxifen, 20 milligram for 5 years. Or what else? What else can we do?
We can do a prophylactic mastectomy.
Prophylactic risk reducing mastectomy. Discuss the options. One is tamoxifen for 5 years, other is risk reducing operation. Third is just, lady says, no, I don't want anything. So you can just do surveillance, yearly MRI.
Active.
Yearly MRI. So this is DCIS. In DCIS, the epithelium. In DCIS, the epithelium has an intact lining and basement membrane is intact. Okay. Once basement membrane breaks, then there is a breach in the lumen of the duct and the cells come out. They invade the stroma and that's why we use the term invasive ductal carcinoma. Invasive carcinoma. Okay. So, normal duct, more than 2 layer cells, hyperplasia, atypia, less than 2 ducts, or less than 2 millimeter size, atypical ductal hyperplasia. More than 2 millimeter, more than 2 layers of, more than 2 ducts involved, carcinoma in situ. Basement membrane intact, basement membrane broken, and tumor goes to invade into surrounding stroma. Then it metastasizes to first two. So this is another picture showing the same. Tumor is confined to the ducts, basement membrane intact, then basement membrane is broken down here. Micro infiltration invasion, then frank invasion, and tumors is coming out, and then it goes to the lymphatics and to the bloodstream. Okay, and we have already done this. They say that the prevalence of triple negative breast cancer is slightly higher in Asian countries and Africa compared to United States and Europe. Okay. And usually reported figure is 29 to 46%. Our data suggested 22% in our cohort in the Department of Surgery or Institute. Now, so what is special about triple negative? Usually it's more aggressive and age of presentation may be slightly younger and it may also come with more of locally breast cancer, and it is also related to family history. Okay, so below 50 triple negative, you should do BRCA gene testing because it may be related to which type, BRCA1 or BRCA2? Triple negative. Hello, are you listening?
BRCA1, sir.
BRCA1 is more related to triple negative. BRCA2 often has estrogen receptor positive.
Hormone positive.
Hormone positive. It may be P. Yeah, mostly it is ER positive. ER only is rare. Okay. So, the tumor, invasive tumor in the breast follows a usually an orderly sequence of spread. Initially, local growth, invasion, and then infiltration. First is extravasation. It extravasation or intravasation. First, it will go into the lymphatics. So intravasation. Then it travels along the lymphatics to the first set of nodes. First set of nodes called
first echelon of node.
sentinel lymph nodes. Sentinel nodes are defined as node having the highest probability of involvement. Okay. So the catchment area of the mammary gland, these are the first station nodes, and from there tumor cells will travel to higher echelon, higher order nodes, go to higher nodes, and then go to apical. And from apical, what will happen? The front of the apical will form what? A lymph trunk, which is called subclavian lymph trunk. Subclavian lymph trunk will join the jugular lymph trunk and jugular and subclavian lymph trunk then will open onto the right lymphatic duct on the right side, and on the left side they will open thoracic duct. Very good. So from the upper limb, axillary lymph, subclavian lymph trunk, from the head and neck area, jugular lymph trunk, and the two join on the left side to thoracic duct and on the right side to the right lymphatic duct. And it is also joined by bronchomediastinal lymph trunk from the lungs and pleura and mediastinal, bronchomediastinal. So this is how tumor spreads, two centimeter T1, and then T1 to nodal involvement, and then okay. And usually the prognosis changes as the tumor spreads. So in situ tumors, impalpable lesions, it's almost 100% survival. In situ, less than 1 centimeter, very small, no nodal spread, and you do surgery. If it is lumpectomy, then you have to give radiotherapy. If you have done full mastectomy for DCIS, it's curative. 98% 20-year survival for in situ tumors. Okay. 2% may still die because of, not due to DCIS. DCIS never kills.
Recurrence in the form of invasive carcinoma.
No.
Or focus of invasion. Missed focus of invasion.
Missed focus of invasion may be hidden. You know, usually they cut the full breast into like loaf of a bread. It's called bread loafing. So they cut 1 centimeter slices. Within two 1 centimeter cuts, there may be a small focus of invasion, which the pathologist missed it. And 10 years down the line, there may be metastasis from that focus. Focus, of course, has metastasized at the time of surgery. So, 2% may still die due to missed invasive focus. Okay, and then it goes to regional nodes, then prognosis goes to 88%, and so on. You know, 5-year survival will be only about 15-16% if tumor has spread to lungs, liver, brain, and bone. And there are very few long term survivals in metastatic stage 4 disease. So, when we talk of management of breast cancer, we should classify them as care of the breast and care of the axilla. And they are two separate entities. Professor Ismail Yatui is a very world famous breast surgeon, probably the senior most breast surgeon in the world. He is often the editor in chief of Surgical Clinics of North America for the breast volume. And he has written many books on breast diseases. You should read them. So he says that don't mix the two. Care of the breast is exactly entirely separate issue, and care of axilla is separate. Okay, so treat the two things separately. So today we'll talk of the breast, and someday later talk of the axillary evaluation. So we have noticed a paradigm shift in treatment of breast cancer from Halstead mastectomy, which William Stuart Halstead started in 1882, and we moved to modified radical mastectomy by Sir David Petty in 1948, and then breast conservation starting in 70s by Sir Umberto Veronese, and then segmental resection and even smaller and smaller surgeries. And we are dreaming of a future where there will be no surgery and just ablation by some rays. Okay, and who knows, immunotherapy and other therapies may take over and make the surgeons redundant. They may still have to do laparotomy for metastasis, you know, or obstruction, but no breast surgery. So mastectomy is offered if patient wants. It is her body, her disease. So let her make the choice. Madam, we discuss the options, offer the options, give her some information in a multidisciplinary team where you have a surgeon, medical oncologist, radiation oncologist, breast care nurse, and plastic surgeon, and genetic counselor if you have one. And then say, madam, you have a large tumor, it will be best treated by mastectomy, or you have a small tumor, it can be best treated by lumpectomy, but it is your decision. Current data shows that disease-free survival, overall survival are almost exactly similar whether we offer full breast removal in the form of mastectomy or breast conservation. Right? So, survival-wise, there is no difference whether you do mastectomy or do lumpectomy for early breast cancer. We are talking of early breast cancer. Okay? In early breast cancer, there's no difference in the survival whether we do lumpectomy or mastectomy. Provided you take care of adjuvant hormone therapy, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and so on. And immunotherapy if indicated. Now, for tumors which remain, so we have patient came with a 5 cm tumor. You arranged preoperative chemotherapy. Tumor is still more than 4 cm size. Treatment is mastectomy. Okay, so that's why we assess the lady after 2 cycles of chemotherapy and then make a decision. If there is more than 30% regression in the largest diameter, more than 30% regression in the largest diameter is called, what is it called? In RECIST criteria? RECIST criteria? Hello?
Responsive.
Good response. Good partial response.
Partial response.
Partial regression. PR. Partial regression or partial remission. 30% or more in the largest diameter. This is called RECIST criteria. What is the full form of the acronym RECIST? R-E-C-I-S-T?
Response evaluation in solid tumor.
Response evaluation criteria. C is for criteria. Criteria in solid tumors. Very good. And there's a PET CT response. PET CT RECIST also.
Persist. It's called persist.
Persist. Okay. Persist. Okay. So, you have arranged chemotherapy, 2 cycles are over, assess her 3 weeks after the second cycle, because that's the time when maximum tumor cell kill would have been achieved. Then measure the size. If it is still more than 4 cm, usually these patients will be better served by mastectomy. Okay, minimal response. Some people will change to second line chemotherapy, but second line chemotherapy in our setup is like gambling. Suppose second line chemotherapy doesn't work, then what? Then third line chemotherapy like carboplatin and gemcitabine, they are very, very expensive and more side effects, and very few people can afford. You know, even in Ayushman Bharat program, they are not given free. The first line, including trastuzumab, etc., are given free up to 5 lakh total cost by the Ayushman Bharat program of Government of India, but these third line and more sophisticated drugs are not covered. So we offer surgery if tumor has regressed less than 30% in the largest diameter. Okay, because second line chemotherapy is like gambling, and if it doesn't respond, then what? So we keep the second line after surgery. So minimal regression or more than 4 cm after 2 cycles, do mastectomy. And then, if there is a histological residual tumor, there is a pathological evaluation after chemotherapy. What is it called? Miller.
Miller pain grade.
PAYNE. Miller pain classification of grading of response to chemotherapy. Right? You should read about it. Miller pain in the exam they may ask about it. So, and then after chemotherapy, second line chemotherapy can be offered, and some people put them on long term oral capecitabine. It's called metronomic therapy, oral capecitabine for residual tumor after chemotherapy. Now for multicentric And large multifocal, again, treatment of choice is multi-mastectomy. If you have microcalcification, filling the whole breast or more than 4 centimeter diameter, then treatment is mastectomy, extensive microcalcification. If you have done lumpectomy and chemotherapy and radiotherapy, BCT, and 2 years later, she has recurrence in the breast, then treatment is mastectomy. Why? Because you cannot, after lumpectomy, you have to give radiotherapy. Radiotherapy after radiotherapy to the same breast is usually associated with high risk of radionecrosis. You know why? Because radiation causes mitotic arrest, prolonged mitotic arrest in Z0, G1 cell boundary, right? Mitotic arrest in Z0 phase of the cell cycle. Z0 means cells are not dividing. For healing, you need rapid division of the cells, of the epithelium for mitosis, fibroblast mitosis. So after second surgery, you need some healing of the cells. And then when you offer radiotherapy, there is some radiation reaction that will also heal by mitosis of the epithelium. If you have caused mitotic arrest by the first radiotherapy, 5,000 to 6,000 centigrade, then cells are in prolonged mitotic arrest. They will not undergo mitosis. They will not cause healing. There will be necrosis. It's called radionecrosis. So that's why most radiotherapists do not want to give full dose of radiation after previous radiation, especially if given within 2 years period.
2 years.
After 2 years, you know, after 10 years, you know, they may still, try to give radiotherapy. Okay. So radiotherapy after radiotherapy usually has high problem necrosis. That's why they say once recurrence after breast conservation surgery, do full mastectomy. Now you have done lumpectomy, margin positive, margin revision, again repeat margin positive. So margin positivity twice is considered as a feature of diffuse nature of the cancer. Diffuse nature of the cancer, which was missed by palpation, missed by mammogram, missed by imaging. So microscopic cells are not seen by mammogram. You only see a large lesion. You don't see microscopic cells. Fingers also cannot palpate those cells. That's why in DCIS, sometimes we get margin positivity. Although we have removed the entire lesion, even under ultrasound guidance, we still see some margin positivity. So repeated margin twice after lumpectomy, that's an indication for mastectomy. Okay. And any reason for not giving radiotherapy, such as autoimmune
connective tissue disorders.
Yes, SLE, sclerosing adenosis, scleroderma, or if lady has severe orthopnea due to cardiac failure, she cannot lie on the radiotherapy table more than few seconds in one posture. Ankylosing spondylitis, bamboo spine, she cannot lie straight on the radiation table. These are relative contraindication to radiotherapy. Or on the left-sided tumor, she had severe cardiomegaly due to cardiomyopathy or coronary artery disease. Again, radiotherapists fear more cardiac damage. Even with current generation IMRT, IGRT, there is some radiation going to the underlying coronary arteries, the anterior descending branch of the left coronary artery, LAD, and myocardium. So if there is underlying heart disease and left-sided tumor, it is safer to do full mastectomy and then avoid the harmful effects of radiation. Studies have shown in Oxford overview that 20 years later, ladies who had received radiation on left-sided tumor, they died of heart disease. They had no cancer. So they were cured of cancer, but they died of heart disease. So radiation can cause prolonged, delayed heart disease and deaths. So just be careful about it. So breast conservation, again, if lady wants, you have to respect her desire. Tumor usually should be single tumor, one quadrant, that is unifocal. less than 4 centimeter. If tumor is more than 4 centimeter and she still wants to preserve the breast, what do you do? Chemotherapy. If she is 80-year-old, hormone receptor positive, not fit for chemotherapy, you can offer tamoxifen or hormone therapy. So neoadjuvant hormone or chemotherapy, if tumor is more than 4 and she patient wants breast conservation. Radiotherapy is mandatory. So you should ensure that after surgery, your lady will get radiotherapy in a nearby center in the short time interval. You should not delay the radiotherapy more than 5 weeks or 6 weeks later. Okay. So oncoplasty is a new method of wide removal of the tumor, wide local excision, WLE, achieving excellent cosmesis. It is defined as a tumor excision with wide margin, followed by repair of the mammary defect by local rearrangement of the breast tissue and relocation of the nipple areola complex, NAC, NAC, to maintain shape and symmetry of the breast. That is full definition of oncoplasty. We'll talk more about it. So it's a plastic surgical reconstructive technique of mammary reconstruction after removal of the tumor. So this lady had a small tumor, 11 millimeter somewhere here, lower upper outer quadrant, and we removed it from the side. So from a lateral crease incision, we did sentinel node biopsy, nodes were negative, and we went inside the breast from inside without removing the skin, just a tiny, you know, you can see a scar here, but we removed the tumor from inside, outer upper quadrant, and did oncoplasty. Last year she had come after 10 years of follow-up. She is alive, happy and healthy. So oncoplasty offers, and you can see size, shape, level of nipple areola, symmetry, projection, every parameter. She achieved excellent outcome cosmesis wise. This lady had a tumor in upper outer quadrant. We perform axillary dissection and excision and achieved excellent cosmetic outcome. This lady had a Paget's disease, erosion of the nipple. So we perform a sentinel node biopsy, sentinel node in the axillary lateral mammary crease incision, and then offered a central core excision. This is a type of breast conservation, BCT, where centrally located tumor in retroareolar area or in Paget's disease, we perform, so just a circular cut around the areola and like ice cream cup, remove the full ductolobular system, go down to the pectoral fascia. So just like a cup of ice cream, you remove the central part of the breast. It is called central core excision, central core excision. And there are many methods of closing this defect. One method is called pulse string closer. Apply a pulse string suture and 2 or 3 layers, a deeper layer to the tissues, just superficial to pectoralis major, with a strong suture such as number 10 or 1 polydiaxinone or Maxon suture, which will be absorbed slowly. And second layer of persisting suture in the middle layer in the mammary tissue, and the third one will be near the skin. So this is called persisting closure of the central core defect following removal of the Paget's disease. Okay, central core excision. So this lady has healed well after central core excision. There is no nipple areola complex, but at least the breast mound and breast is well maintained. Later on, if she desires, you can reform nipple areola. Plastic surgical procedures can be carried out where you can put a skin from the inner side of the thigh or labia, which has the same color as the areola, dark skin, and that can form a new areola as a free graft, free skin graft. And later on, from that skin graft, somebody can make a new nipple, thus recreating the nipple areola complex. So central core excision, and she also had a sentinel node biopsy. Okay, so this is one method of breast conservation. if tumor is near the nipple areola complex but going to the surrounding tissue also, so volume loss is more than about 20 to 30%, then you do replacement of this tissue from adjoining part of the surrounding structures like latissimus dorsi. So this is called oncoplasty with volume replacement. Volume replacement, okay? Volume replacement is take the tissue from other outside the breast. And volume displacement is when you suture the tissue nearby. So like this example, this Paget's disease, here we are closing the surrounding breast tissue, right? This is called volume displacement. Displace, you displace the tissue from this area to this area. So local displacement. This is oncoplasty by volume displacement, and that latissimus dorsi is volume replacement. Okay. Now you can perform nipple areola sparing mastectomy. Traditionally, it was recommended for small tumors less than 3 cm, which are located away from the nipple areola complex, more than 2 cm away. This was the classical description when the nipple areola mastectomy came into the picture. And original literature suggested that you should not do it in Paget's disease because it's involving the nipple areola. You should never do an inflammatory carcinoma and extensive intraductal carcinoma. Okay. Oncologic safety of the skin sparing mastectomy has been well established in large prospective cohort studies. There's a large study from Glasgow, another one from MD Anderson Hospital, Texas. They all have demonstrated the safety, oncologic safety, that recurrence rate is in the tune of 2 to 3%, which is same as the recurrence after conventional mastectomy. So provided you choose the subjects appropriately, you will achieve the same local recurrence as in conventional mastectomy. Okay. Now these four ladies had undergone full removal of the breast. Can you tell which side was removed? You don't see any scar, but her full left breast was removed and filled by a silicone gel implant, right? She had skin sparing mastectomy and nipple sparing and an implant. And she later on received radiotherapy also. This lady had bilateral skin sparing and bilateral silicone implant. This lady had left side and she also received radiotherapy. This lady again, left breast, okay? So you don't see any scar because scars are hidden on the side. So this is about skin sparing mastectomy. That's another method of treatment of early breast cancer, especially suited for multicentric disease. For multicentric, this is the only rational treatment if tumor is away from nipple areola complex and skin. It should be a ideally once more than 1 cm away from the skin and at least 2 cm away from the nipple areola. If it is deep to nipple areola, then we can take a frozen section of the milk ducts and confirm that there are no tumors in cells in the milk ducts. Now, other methods of reconstruction can also be used, like free flap from the abdomen. It's called deep inferior epigastric fasciocutaneous flap, DIEP. DIEP. It's based on inferior epigastric artery and vessel system. It's a free flap for microvascular anastomosis has to be done. Taking the artery and vein from the abdomen here, then anastomosing to the either internal mammary artery, first or second perforator of internal mammary, or to the lateral thoracic or to the thoracodorsal artery. It heals very well and provides excellent cosmesis, but it takes 4 to 5 hours to perform. And if the anastomosis thrombosis, then you lose the whole flap. Image-guided surgery can be done for small lesions. which are not easily palpable. So you take the lady to the mammogram room. They will locate it by stereotactic technique and pass a wire. A wire is passed into the lesion. You confirm that the radiologist has placed the tip of the wire next to the lesion. Then the lady is taken to the operation theater with the wire inside too. The wire is very thin, so you cannot easily see in this picture, but we place an incision close to the insertion of the wire and remove the lesion with the wire, send the specimen to mammography room again to make sure that the wire is indeed in the center of that lesion and all the microcalcification are included. They count the number of calcification and then send the specimen to the pathology. Okay, so this is called wire-guided excision. This is another form of treatment of breast. So these are some of the principles involved in
breast. It's 1930.
Please tell me if you want to continue or have a separate session. Hello?
Avila, yes, sir.
You want to continue or have a separate session? You are bored.
Sir, you can continue.
Sure.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then we have just few more slides. Whenever we talk of breast conservation, we must pay a tribute and respect to these four gentlemen. Professor Umberto Veronesi, he said that if lady has been so careful and intelligent enough to come to the doctor with a very early tumor, she has been health conscious, then we should reward her appropriately by doing a nice, we should gift her with a breast preservation surgery. So he was the first surgeon in the world, Professor Umberto Veronesi. He is like a grandfather of oncology in the world. He established the world famous Milan Cancer Institute, European Institute of Oncology in Milan in Italy. And if you get a chance, you should visit this center. And Dr. Veronesi started breast conservation initially for small tumors, and it became popular as a quadrantectomy. He would remove one fourth quadrant of the tumor with radiotherapy and axillary dissection, QUART, quart. So this is the first gentleman, Veronesi, to do breast conservation. Then these two gentlemen, Dr. Jean Petit and Dr. Krishna Clau from Paris Institute of Breast Surgery. And Dr. Petit also works in Milan Institute with Dr. Veronesi. They were among the first to perform large-scale oncoplasty and develop most of the current techniques of breast oncoplasty. It is said that this gentleman, I think a German surgeon, Dr. Odrich, was the first man to actually describe oncoplasty. But it was popularized by Dr. Krishna Clau of Paris and Dr. Jean Petit of Paris as well as Milan. Okay, so just remember a few great men in breast surgery. So there are two trials which are often quoted to support the breast conservation. One trial is called NSABP B06 trial. NSABP is an organization called National Surgical Adjuvant Breast and Bowel Project, NSABP. And they have different nomenclature. B is for breast and for colon cancer also. They do trials in all types of cancers, right? So NSABP B06 trial was the first one where they established, it was started in 1976, and they took 1851 ladies to randomize either to lumpectomy followed by radiotherapy, lumpectomy alone, or modified radical mastectomy, which was the standard of care at that time, and starting in 1976 August and went on till 1984, a total of 2163 women with invasive cancer presenting with less than 4 centimeter tumor. They were randomized into three groups. And what did they find at the end of 20 years of follow-up? They found that if you do lumpectomy with radiotherapy, you have 14% local recurrence in the breast. If you do lumpectomy alone, local recurrence is 39%, very high. And if you do MRM, modified radical mastectomy, local recurrence is still 10%. So you can see that mastectomy is the most successful and effective treatment of breast cancer. In Hindi, there is a phrase, there is a saying, Na rahega baans, na bajegi baansuri. So breast cancer arises from the ductal lobular tissue, TDLU. If you do not leave any TDLU in the breast, there's no question of any cancer. Some cancers can still occur because you are leaving some peripheral ducts, or if you are doing a skin sparing, you are leaving some milk ducts in the nipple. So 10% recurrence can still occur, right? This was the first study which showed or demonstrated the safety of breast conservation or lumpectomy if given along with radiotherapy, having almost similar, slightly higher recurrence, but most similar to modified radical mastectomy. This data was published in year 2002 in this journal, and I have given this page number so you can go to this article and read more about it. 20-year follow-up of a randomized trial of mastectomy, lumpectomy, and lumpectomy with radiation. Okay? A very nice classic article. And so this confirmed that breasts can be conserved with an adequate margin and maintaining shape and size. Another large famous trial is called the Veronese trial or Milan 1 trial, where they perform quadrantectomy with 2 centimeter margin versus Halsted radical mastectomy. It was done for T1 tumors, only up to 2 centimeter tumor. Dr. Veronese chose to perform either breast conservation or Halsted mastectomy. Please remember. Hello? Yeah? Any question?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Any question?
Sir, you may continue, sir.
Okay, thank you. So please remember the 1973, the Halsted radical mastectomy was the standard of care. Okay, that's why in one group, in randomized trial, the principle is that if you have two groups, one is your new treatment, which you want to test, and you want to compare with the gold standard, with the standard of care at that time. So the standard of care at that time in 1973 in Europe, Milan, was Halsted radical mastectomy, where both pectoralis major and minor both are removed along with full level 1, 2, and 3 axillary nodes. Okay, and skin over the breast, nipple areolar complex, at least 2 centimeter skin over the breast. So this was removed, and it again 20 year follow up were published in the same issue of New England Journal of Medicine, and this is the page number given. 701 patients were taken into this trial, and they completed 29 years of follow-up. Just imagine such extensive follow-up and data record keeping in Europe. Local recurrence was 8%, 8.8 at the end of 20-year follow-up after this quadrantectomy, and 2.3% in Halsted mastectomy. Okay, 2.3 versus 8. So four times more recurrence in lumpectomy radiotherapy. Okay, so again you can see that mastectomy is the most effective treatment of breast cancer. So if some lady asks which treatment should I have to reduce or to minimize chances of recurrence, you can say that mastectomy will have lowest recurrence. However, current data with modern targeted therapy, hormone therapy, chemotherapy, and modern radiotherapy shows that the recurrence rate in breast conservation versus the mastectomy is almost similar. Almost similar. Slight difference, but almost similar. Okay. So then the another trial was carried out by same gentleman, Dr. Umberto Veronese, called Milan 2 trial. Milan 2 trial, Dr. Veronese, where they performed 1 centimeter versus 2 centimeter margin. And 1 centimeter margin removal was associated with 13% local recurrence compared to 5% recurrence with 2 centimeter margin. So this confirmed that higher margin, 2 centimeter margin will have less recurrence, 5% versus 13% recurrence at 15 year if you take less margin of 1 centimeter. So this was in 1990, okay, when they were giving CMF, cyclophosphamide, methotrexate and 5-FU. And the what was negative margin? Negative margin was defined as no tumor on the ink, no ink on tumor. Okay, so no tumor on the ink margin was defined as the negative margin. Okay, so just to give, I think I'll we perform ultrasound guided excision. So we place the ultrasound probe covered with a sterile camera cover, put some drop of sterile lignocaine jelly inside the camera cover and then apply on the tumor, and we apply this ioband. You can see this plastic, you know, sheet which covers the whole breast. This makes the breast tumor steady, otherwise it is moving like a breast mouse as fibroadenoma moves, you know. To make it steady, we apply this sheet ioband and then do ultrasound location. And then under, once we have seen the margin on ultrasound, then we take a ruler and 1 or 2 centimeter margin and then put a drop of methylene blue, just one drop, 0.1 ml from a tuberculin syringe using 26 gauge needle, a drop of methylene blue. So you know what we do? We take this tuberculin syringe, fill half with lignocaine jelly first. Then you fill with methylene blue. This way, your methylene blue becomes thick like honey, viscous. So other, if you inject only methylene blue, it's a very thin aqueous solution and it diffuses in the breast tissue very rapidly, and the whole picture, the whole area will be just bluish and you will not be able to locate it. So make it thick, viscid like honey by mixing it with lignocaine jelly. And then once you cut the skin, then you will find those blue dots where you have injected all around the tumor, and then remove those blue dots and the tumor margin. And then you do a specimen sonography again and to confirm that. And studies have shown that this way, and then you can reduce the local recurrence and margin positivity. Then having done that, then you approximate the breast parenchyma plate by mobilizing from the underlying pectoral fascia and then suture it with absorbable sutures like polydaxanon, or you can use Maxon suture, absorbable suture 20 or 10 by figure of 8 sutures, and this way to approximate the tissues so that there is no wound cavity. Okay, so these are some of the incisions that you can use around the nipple areola complex or over the tumor. If tumor is within 5 millimeter from the skin, then we remove the overlying skin. Otherwise, we do not remove the skin. So these are various incisions used here. So here, tumor was close to skin. So we excise with the ellipse of the skin on the tumor. Okay. If tumor is away from the skin, there is no need to remove the skin. Right? Like this tumor is located here. So just place an incision at the areola, go inside and then remove those blue dots and suture it. If tumor is located in 6 o'clock position near the inframammary crease, it's here. This is inframammary crease. This is the nipple areola complex. So you design like a bat wing incision and like this, and mobilize the two breast plates, two corners, and then join like an inverted T, just as you do reduction myoplasty. Okay, so these are some of the incisions that we can use. You can do a round block incision as in this lady, or a Grisotti flap, and this. So just to show you some pictures, you can't make out, you know, there was an incision here, circumerular. We went inside because tumor was away from his skin, more than 1 centimeter. So no need of removing the overlying skin and remove those along those blue dots and sutured the skin back. If tumor is located laterally and if you have to do X-ray dissection, then this is one incision described, lateral crease incision along with the axilla. Okay. If the tumor is located lower outer quadrant, as in this lady, we performed excision by this radial incision. So in the lower half, radial incision is better. In the upper half, circumerular or parallel to the axilla. Okay, that's a general principle. Please remember, upper half, circumerular or parallel to areola. Yes. Upper half, parallel to areola, circumerular or parallel. Okay. Lower half, vertical or radial. Lower half radial and upper half circumerular. If you, this will achieve the best cosmesis. Okay. Radial incision in lower half. This lady had a Grisotti flap. You know what Grisotti flap is? Then, or this is just a closer by removal of the nipperula complex. Simple closer, wedge, removal of the wedge. Large tumor, and we had to do this radial because there was some involvement of the skin. So we had to remove a ellipse of the skin here. Okay. This is a tumor located at 6 o'clock position. So inverted T. Inverted T, mammoplasty. And then this is a picture soon after radiotherapy. So you can see the radiation dermatitis marks here. Lateral crease incision here. Okay, so this is round block. In round block, what you do, that you remove a rim of tissue. It's also called Benelli's technique. Remove a rim of tissue around the areola and then remove the tumor, and then you apply a persisting suture and join the skin of the breast to the areola persisting by a persisting suture. Round block technique or Benelli's technique. Okay. This lady had a Grisotti flap for circumerular. So tumor was removed from the central part and you take a flap from the lower part of the breast and move it. It's like a rotation advancement flap, and you make a new nipple areola, not nipple, but new areola by taking a skin from this area, and this is called Grisotti flap. So these are different techniques of the breast reconstruction. Now if there are any questions, you have to give radiotherapy to the breast after breast conservation. Okay. Now, Dr. Jusa, if there are any questions, please let me know.
Sir, for practical surgical purposes, what should be the adequate margin that we should take peritumorally?
1 centimeter. Most authors will recommend 1 centimeter margin gross.
Okay, sir. Gross.
If you have a good radiologist in your hospital, then please request her or him to come to with you in operation theater, scrub with you, and you take an ultrasound machine, cover the probe with a sterile camera cover, you know, camera cover used for laparoscopy, same camera cover, and use that ultrasound probe to locate the tumor margin, and then do ultrasound guided excision, because this is more precise than palpation guided study. And there's one large trial from Netherlands. It's called COBALT trial, COBALT, published in Lancet Oncology in 2013, January, page number 48, where they showed that removal of the tumor by blind palpation had 17% positive margin. So 17% chance of positive margin. So they had to take the lady back for revision of margin. When they did ultrasound guided excision, only 2.9% revision of margin. So 2.9 versus 17, marked difference. And therefore, we perform all our excision under ultrasound guidance. Okay. So wherever possible, perform ultrasound guided 1 centimeter margin. And then after removal of the specimen, you should do sonography of the specimen. Sonography of the specimen should be done to make sure that all the margins are negative. If any margin on specimen sonography is less than 5 millimeter, we take a cavity shape. Suppose lateral margin is positive, less than 5 millimeter on sonography of the specimen, then we will take another cavity shape, maybe about 4 or 5 millimeter thick, and put a blue ink, methylene blue, away from the tumor, and put a suture, silk suture, and write in the specimen lateral cavity shave, blue ink and black silk suture placed away from tumor. This is important because if suppose this is cavity shave is like this, okay, there's one concave surface where the tumor was and one convex surface. If tumor is positive on the inner side but absent on the outer side, that is fine. If it is going on the outer side also, you have to do the another cavity shave. So this is important that you label the cavity shave appropriately, suture and blacking away from tumor. Okay. And then before closure, place 5 titanium LIGA clips, same LIGA clips which you use in lab pulleys, 200 or 300, any size, you know. One on the posterior wall near the pectoralis muscle, posterior wall, and then superior, medial, lateral, and inferior. 4 clips on the 4 walls and 1 on the posterior wall before closure of the breast wound. This will allow the radiotherapist to locate the site of the primary tumor you have removed, and then they will give radiation only to that area, only to that area. So that's the advantage of marking the, okay, marking the margin. So any other question?
Sir, what is the difference between oncoplastic surgery and breast reconstruction surgery?
Sorry?
What is the basic difference between oncoplastic surgery and breast reconstruction?
Oncoplasty and breast reconstruction. Actually, oncoplasty is a type of breast reconstruction. It is a simple form of breast reconstruction by using local flaps, right? So we are reconstructing whether partial breast reconstruction or total breast reconstruction. Okay, so you can classify breast reconstruction as partial, like in this lady, right? We have reconstructed. We removed tumor with 2 centimeter, say 2 centimeter margin, and then reconstructed the breast in such a way that it looks like normal. See, from the front as well as from the side, we have not distorted, we have not changed the size, shape, projection, nipple areola level, everything is remains the same. So we have reconstructed the breast only partially. So oncoplasty is a type of local breast reconstruction, either mobilizing the breast tissue, breast parenchymal plates, joining them together to achieve excellent cosmesis, location of nipple areola and symmetry. It is called oncoplasty. When you remove the whole breast, mastectomy, then usually we say whole breast reconstruction. So both are reconstruction, partial or whole. Breast reconstruction can also be done by silicone implants or by autologous tissue transfer, like a small dorsi myocutaneous flap can be taken from the back, or abdominal wall flap can be taken, rectus abdominis flap or deep inferior epigastric flap, or deep flaps can be taken from the thigh, It's called anterolateral thigh flap in Tata Memorial Hospital. Plastic surgeons are very fond of this anterolateral or ALT flaps. It's a microvascular tissue transfer based on the vastus lateralis, the muscle, and the perforator of the lateral circumflex femoral artery. And so it's a tissue, they are all types of breast reconstruction.
Okay. Dr. Lagas, tissue. What tissues are taken for reconstruction of nipple?
So reconstruction of the nipple can be undertaken if areola is intact. Then there's a very simple plastic surgery procedure, and they just do some under local anesthesia. You raise two flaps to skin, elevate the skin and make a new nipple. If there is no areola, then first you reconstruct the areola by taking skin from the inner side of the thigh or labia majora, which looks like brown skin of the areola. It has almost the same color. And then wait for it to heal. This is taken as a free skin graft. And once it has healed, after a few months, then plastic surgeon will reconstruct the nipple on it. A simpler technique is like a tattoo. You just tattoo the skin, which looks like nipple area. Okay. Any other questions?
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, pectoralis minor, is it a part of the chest wall or not? Because many people ask that in the exam. Pectoralis minor.
No, when we say chest wall involvement by breast cancer, called T4A, we count the serratus anterior, intercostal muscles, sternum, costal cartilage, ribs only. Okay. Pectoralis minor is behind the pectoralis major. So, in order to involve, tumor has to penetrate through pectoralis major and then go to pectoralis minor. Okay. So, pectoralis major and minor usually are not called chest wall muscles. So, it is not considered, pectoral muscle involvement is not called chest wall involvement. When in the TNM classification, T4A means chest wall infiltration, and chest wall infiltration means infiltration of the ribs, costal cartilage, sternum, serratus anterior, okay, and yes, not the pectoral muscles.
Sir, and stage 2B is classified as early breast cancer or locally advanced breast cancer?
T1, that is 2 centimeter. T2 up to 5 centimeter, node negative N0 or early node positive, they will be called early breast cancer. But personally, I feel that once tumor has gone to nodes, it is advanced. It has metastasized from primary breast to regional nodes. So, but classical description is T1, T2, N0, N1 is early. T3, T4, N2 or N3. Advanced, or M1. M1 is metastatic.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, if a patient of EBC having N1 and the patient is opted for BCS, then what will be the management of axillary lymph node in this case?
So, axillary evaluation is carried out by high-resolution ultrasound probe, 6 to 13 megahertz probe, and if any node is found suspicious, then a senior experienced radiologist performs ultrasound guided core needle biopsy of the suspicious nodes by a 18 gauge core needle biopsy. 18 gauge for the breast primary, we use 14 gauge core needle biopsy. For the axillary node, 18 gauge. Why 18? Narrower. Because if you put very thick needle in the axilla, where there are axillary vein, axillary artery, and brachial plexus, you may injure them. And it must be done by an experienced radiologist. And the needle must go parallel to the axillary vessels, not at 90 degree. Otherwise, you injure. So, the axillary node is biopsied under ultrasound. 18 gauge needle. If it shows tumor cells in the node, then you have confirmed the presence of metastasis in the axillary node. This lady goes for axillary node dissection, ALND. Okay, axillary lymph node dissection.
Thank you. Thank you.
That is the treatment. For with treatment of the breast and treatment of the axilla, two different entities. Okay, don't mix with the two. Sometimes if tumor is located in, say, this area, okay, upper outer quadrant, then we can combine same incision. I have one picture. Yeah, okay. Like this lady, okay. So here, there were nodes involvement and the tumor is here. So we combine the two, and by same incision, you can do axillary node dissection as well as removal of the tumor in outer upper quadrant. Okay. But otherwise, you try to do two lesions, treat separately.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's 20 hours.
Any other question?
Dr. Santosh has some question.
Yes, please. Yes, please. Hello, Dr. Santosh. Yes, please. Go ahead.
Not available. Sir, somebody has asked if wide local excision and lumpectomy are different or same.
They are synonyms. Why we use the word wide because we do not want to cut through the tumor. Transtumoral resection is a sin. Is a sin. Never commit that sin, and it will cause on-table recurrence. So transtumoral resection, cutting through the tumor, will cause on-table, on-OT table recurrence. So never do commit that sin. You should never be seeing the tumor. Our teachers used to say, you should not be seeing the tumor. You should stay away from the tumor. And modern ultrasound probe is a great boon, is a great friend of a surgeon. You can see where the tumor margin is and stay away from the tumor. So, stay away from the tumor. The terms are lumpectomy, breast conservation surgery, wide local excision, or WLE, segmental resection, quadrantectomy, sector excision. These are all synonyms for breast conservation, where major portion of the breast is preserved. That is called breast conservation surgery, BCS.
So one question, can you please repeat how this new adjuvant chemotherapy response is actually graded?
Okay, so you offer neoadjuvant chemotherapy after taking core biopsies, at least 5 cores, to assess the grade, the type of site tumor, invasive tumor, the type of cancer, whether it is mucinous or papillary, and so on, and whether it is ER, PR, HER, Ki-67 grading status, and then one course, and you should then arrange her to come to your daycare clinic or OT, where you, under local anesthesia, with the help of anesthetist, you should place a chemoport. Chemoport is a device where we can inject anti-cancer drugs or other drugs without puncturing a vein every time. So it preserves the veins, patency of the veins. It's a great blessing for patients who receive multiple injections into their veins. So yes, place sir. A chemoport under local anesthesia. The jugular vein puncture should be done. The NICE guidelines suggest that internal jugular vein puncture under ultrasound guidance is the preferred method of putting the chemoport, because incidence of rupture into the pleura, that is pleural effusion, or pneumothorax or hematoma of the subclavian vessels, are least when we puncture the internal jugular vein under ultrasound guidance. So the senior resident of the anesthesia department are quite expert in puncturing the interjugular vein under ultrasound guidance. In ICU, they are doing it every day. So request them to puncture the interjugular vein for you. And then you make a tunnel deep to the skin and put a chemopod on the opposite infraclavicular fossa. And 1 week after this chemopod insertion, once the wound has healed, then you can inject anti-cancer drugs through it. So get 2 cycles of chemotherapy injected. Call her 3 weeks after the second course. Examine the lump. Measure with a caliper. If initial tumor was 10 centimeter, now it is 7 centimeter. That means 30% has regressed. This is called partial regression. So 30% or more regression from the original size tells you that at least 30% of the cells have been killed by the anti-cancer drugs. So this tumor is likely to regress more. So why not give this lady and this tumor a chance to complete all 6 cycles at 3 weekly time apart and complete all 6 chemotherapies and then call her for surgery. This way, you can achieve complete pathological remission. Complete pathological remission can be achieved, especially if you use taxane and anthracycline. So, docetaxel and epirubicin combination can achieve complete pathological remission about 30 to 40% cases. And this should be your aim. Give all 6 cycles continuously and then do the surgery. Because studies have shown that those ladies who achieve complete pathological remission of the tumor by preoperative chemotherapy have a better survival, lesser recurrence compared to those ladies who do not have complete pathological remission. Okay? And after surgery, you need not give any further chemotherapy if histologically there is complete pathological remission. You just put her on tamoxifen or anastrozole if it is ER positive, and also add trastuzumab if it is HER rich.
Okay. Sir. Right? If response is less than 30 degrees.
Criteria is called RECIST criteria, RECIST. It is not that racist as they will say that this country is racist against colored people and all. So it is RECIST. Response evaluation criteria in solid tumors. Just type RECIST in Google and you will get the full detail. And, okay. So response evaluation criteria. Partial regression means more than 30% regression, and less than 30% indicates that tumor, most cells are not responding. So you treat her by surgery, 2 cycles, response assessment, less than 30% regression, take her for surgery, and then further chemotherapy, 4 more cycles, depending on the advice of the oncologist. RECIST criteria.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, after chemotherapy, if we get a complete pathological response, how do we manage the patient?
Adjuvant therapy in the form of trastuzumab, if it is HER-rich, tamoxifen, if it's estrogen receptor positive, premenopausal, anastrozole or letrozole, if she is ER-positive, postmenopausal. And if there is residual tumor, then some people give further chemotherapy in the form of the oral capacitor B, oral 5-FU capacitor B.
So no surgery is done if there is complete disappearance of lump.
Complete pathological remission can only be ascertained after surgery. When you remove either the whole breast or the tumor bearing area of the breast by partial breast excision, by lumpectomy, then only pathologist will tell on Miller Payne criteria whether there is complete pathological remission. PCR is the term described by pathologist. You cannot assess it.
Okay.
I think what she wants to ask is after
chemotherapy, if that whole tumor has regressed, our fingers cannot palpate anything. Repeat post chemo mammography does not show any lesion or just microcalcification. No architecture distortion. Ultrasound is normal. Even MRI is normal. Then what to do? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And some oncologists, like in MD Anderson Hospital and few other centers, are doing studies where they have achieved complete clinical remission. It's called clinical remission, right? You can't assess pathology. Then you take several biopsies with vacuum-assisted device, stereotactic biopsies, to show that there are no active living cells, right? And if we have not demonstrated an actually living tumor cells, viable tumor cells, it is reasonable for you to assume that tumor cells have been killed by the chemotherapy, and then you offer radiotherapy to the area, boost to the tumor bed area, tumor site area, and then just follow. And there are some studies where, at least for small tumors, they are trying to avoid surgery. Surgery causes scar, surgery causes pain, surgery causes bleeding. It costs something to the exchequer, to the society. These days in Corona, our OTs are shut, so we can't operate them. So there are many issues with surgery. So all patients, you know, all human beings would like
yes, to
avoid use of knife if possible. So,
yes, sir.
So why not avoid knife? And some patients can achieve complete pathological remission after chemotherapy, radiotherapy, targeted therapy. So just keep them on follow-up surveillance and reserve surgery for residual or recurrent tumor. So surgery reserved for residual or recurrent tumor, otherwise treated by other modalities. In lymphoma and leukemia, we have learned that cancer can be cured with chemotherapy and, if needed, radiotherapy. Hodgkin's disease, you don't operate.
May I just ask?
They don't operate. Just give chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So, same principle is being used in many centers with in selected patients with good use, with results.
Sir, as we had already done wire localization of the lesion, so don't we need to remove that wire with some margin and send that for histopathological examination? After that, we'll decide whether the response was complete or what.
Sure, absolutely, you are correct. Without that, you can never be sure that whole lesion has been removed or not.
Yes, sir. So surgery is anyhow required. That is what I just wanted to ask.
Sorry, surgery is required or not?
Sir, surgery is anyhow required. That is what I wanted to ask you. Because we have already done wire localization and tumor has shrunken completely. So, we have to take some margin around that wire and take out that wire and send it for histopathology and then assess whether the margins or the tissue that we have removed is completely free of tumor or not.
Yes. I'll just show you a picture of wire guidance. I think we had presented it early. Let me just find out.
Hello, sir. I am Dr. Krishna Mujumdar.
Namaskar. Hello to me.
Namaskar, sir.
Hello,
sir. Sir, today is Bengali Navabarsh. Happy Navabarsh to all. And I am communicating with the session and still now stand here. And now a few minutes ago communicate. But I cannot see you clearly, sir. I want to see you clearly. light is problem.
Okay. Can you see now?
No, sir. No? Not clear. It's okay. It's okay, sir.
Can you see now? Okay, so can you see this wire guided thing?
Yes, sir.
So we take the lady with the wire.
Sir, we cannot see the screen. Can you share again? Share screen.
Okay. Share screen.
Yes, exactly, sir. Yes, yes.
Can you see now?
Yes, sir, properly. And happy to see you, sir.
Can you see the screen or not?
No.
No.
Okay.
Yes, sir. I can see you clearly.
Okay. So, no, so you take the insert the wire in the radiology department, take her to the theater, and then remove tissue around the hostess port. Dr. Ajita, I think you have to. Zoom is not working, it seems. So anyway, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you remove the lesion with a rim of tissue around the wire and then do the specimen mammography to make sure that the tissue around the tip of the wire has been removed. And then
hello.
Yes, yes. So, a specimen sonography mammography must be done, and then pathology report should show that there are no tumor cells in the margin, and we should ensure tumor-free margin. And
yes, sir.
Then, if it is cancer, then give radiotherapy. If it is benign, then
yes, sir.
So after wire guided, does that answer your question, sir? Wire guided.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah,
I think some of the audience has a doubt regarding the placement of the ideal time for placement of the clip in course of neoadjuvant chemotherapy,
mm-hmm.
and they're confusing between clip and wire.
Right, the clip is inserted after 2 cycles of chemotherapy when you have found that tumor is regressing and more than 2 centimeter of the tumor, 30% regression has been achieved. Can you?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the screen now?
No.
No? Share screen. Can see the Ratiman's screen.
Yes, sir, we can see.
Okay. Can you see the screen? Anyway,
yes, sir.
So you have seen that there's significant reduction of the tumor, more than 30%. You take her to radiology department, request them to place a titanium or stainless steel clip near the tumor or in the center of the tumor. Continue more chemotherapy. If there is complete regression of the tumor, then at the end, you have a clip there in the center, epicenter of the tumor. You then take her to radiology again, put a wire near that clip and remove the tissue around the wire. Okay, this is for patients who receive neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Instead of a clip and wire, we have developed a very simple technique. We take a tip of a catheter or a nasogastric tube, take 1 centimeter tip of that silicone catheter or nasogastric tube, just 1 centimeter tip, and after 2 cycles, if there is tumor regression, small 11 number, 15 number blade is used to make a small incision on the anterior surface of the tumor, put an artery forceps, make a tunnel anterior to the tumor, place that tip of the catheter, silicone catheter, put one suture. So, when chemotherapy is completed, you will have that palpable tip of the catheter inside the breast where the tumor was. So tip is easily palpable and it is easily seen on ultrasound, and you can just excise tissue around the tip. 2 centimeter tissue around the tip of that catheter can be removed with safely. There's no need to take her to radiology department for insertion of clip and then insertion of wire. All can be under control of surgeon. Very simple technique. You can use it.
So by tunneling, won't we violate the plane of the tumor when we
create? No, we're not puncturing through the tumor, just making a incision in front, anterior to the tumor, cutting the skin and just put a tip of the catheter, 1 centimeter tip of the catheter, and put a stitch. So the tip of the catheter or nasogastric tube stays in front of the anterior to the tumor. We don't puncture the tumor, just anterior.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
And later on, we are going to remove it anyway. We are excising it after 6 cycles of chemotherapy. Any other question? So in the next session, we will discuss the management of axilla, what's the rationale, the data to support various treatments.
Sir, I have one question, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, after training in AIMS under you, sir, when mastectomy, you done mastectomy by C-shaped incision.
Uh-huh.
C-shaped, she's still, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Incision, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
In case of early breast cancer, uh-huh. and in our country, I started firstly a mastectomy by C-shaped incision, and my number is are 35 cases.
Oh, because you like fish, you know.
Yes, sir. And yes, sir. And very, very nice. And I'm too much grateful to you. And it's my blessing. I am a trained person from you, sir. And after C-shaped incision, my patient postoperative serous condition is very low, and patient is discharged third POD or 2 POD, and patient is recovered so early, and my medical oncologist is not habituated to this incision, and he is too much pleasure to see C-shaped incision, because the radiation field is area is too small area, and chance of pleural effusion is low. That's why I am randomly use C-shaped incision, and my Department of Surgery, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University, my teacher is well appreciated me, and I am too much grateful to you to teach me this like incision. And now, without C-shaped incision, no other mastectomy, I am done. That's why. And another, this is my experience, sir. And another, please, my...
Dr. Krishna Majumdar, please publish the results.
Yes, sir. I have
send
already...
Send it to Indian Journal of Surgery, okay? I think you are getting blessings from Fish Devi. Fish Devi is blessing you.
Yes, sir. I am. Yeah. I want to present you Epsicon.
Because we are from Bangkok, and you,
yes, sir.
You bless,
yes, sir.
You worship fish so much that Fish, yes, Devi is blessing you.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have one question.
Dr. Dhatiman will support this idea.
Ha, sir.
Yes, sir. Thanks.
The other one who had come with Dr. Krishna, she is also doing fish a lot these days, and she is also writing a paper on it, I think.
Yes, yes, yes.
They are all
very, yes.
Okay, once Corona attack is over, you know, I will come to Dhaka and see you.
Yes, sir. We are eagerly waiting for you and our, yes, School of Oncoplastic Surgery, Professor Mijan, sir. We are eagerly waiting for you.
My regards to him.
Yes, sir. Of course, sir. Of course. Sir, I have one question to you, and it's this is just diagnostic dialoma. It's not my patient, and referred to us this patient from any other surgeons. The patient have chronic myeloid leukemia and is 65 years age, and feeling like something lumpy appearance in the upper and outer quadrant in the right breast. And ultrasonogram, no 65 years suggest previous surgeon ultrasonogram and mammogram, and also MRI, no positive findings through microcalcification. But MRI result is something like microcalcification, and those surgeon is were guided biopsy. And biopsy report is normal. Then
report is normal.
No, yes, sir.
No lymphoid cells or no leukemia
no,
cells.
No, sir.
Chloroma.
It can be chloroma. Because in leukemia, sometimes
yes, sir.
The cells of the leukemic descent origin, you know, blast cells, may deposit yes, in solid tissues. May deposit exactly. in breast. So we have seen two patients like that. And
yes.
so. It is then confused with other pathology reports like sarcoma and
yes,
so
intramammary lymph node. They will report sometimes as intramammary lymph node.
So
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Careful. Give the pathologist the exact blood picture and the bone marrow picture that the patient is suffering from leukemia, and this can be leukemic deposit in the breast. It's called leukemic deposit in the breast.
Sir, my patient, this patient is come after.
If the biopsy report is just not showing any cancer, just
sir,
let the medical oncologist give chemotherapy after 2 cycle, 3 cycle, again assist.
Patient has already chemotherapy for chronic myeloid leukemia, but the history is not completed, sir. After war-guided biopsy, no sign of any malignancy. Then the surgeon wide local excision do wide local excision and and send histopathologist and sign and no pathology report is no malignancy. Then patient came to me all these reports and very angry with the surgeons and. No chemotherapy start, no suggest medical oncologist, and just before corona, and now patient is telephonic conversation. Now how will do? And I'm referred to the patient to medical oncologist.
Okay. But she had already received some chemotherapy before the lumpectomy, right?
No.
Oh, she chemotherapy did not receive already.
Chemotherapy, but. After surgery, war-guided surgery, two surgery is occur. War-guided surgery, no sign of suspicious malignancy. Then clinical suspicious, but no lump and no lymph node. Then do WLE.
Okay.
Then no sign of no histopathology report is normal, but patient is chronic myeloid leukemia.
Okay.
Patient, now this patient is worried about this, and I then corona situation is already transcommunication occur in our country, and the patient is telephonic conversation, and I refer to the patient to medical oncologist.
Now she should undergo treatment for CML only, and one Philadelphia chromosome can be done. If it is positive, she can be put on oral imatinib until corona. Situation settles.
Thank you so much, Dhritiman. I am happy to hear.
Session is over, I think. What? Sir?
It's still on. I think sir is not here.
Okay.
I think we'll call it and continue next time, whenever there's class next time.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anurag, sir?
जी जी हाँ नमस्कार यस प्लीज
यस सर
हाँ सो वील कंटिन्यू नेक्स्ट टाइम
यस सर
यू डिसाइड द डेट एंड टाइम एंड
यस सर
ऑन एक्सिलरी इवैल्यूएशन ओके एक्सिलरी
यस
थैंक्स अ लॉट सर
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. God bless you, sir.
Stay safe, sir, from corona and all.
Don't get corona.
Ha, sir.
Okay, namaskar.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.